I'm Tamara, and you're listening to TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. From health and wellness to community and social responsibility, this podcast shares stories, busts myths, and delivers practical tips to Canadians when they need it most, bringing together experts, thinkers, and leaders. Hi, everyone. Today, we are talking to Judith Heumann. And for those of you who don't know who Judy is, she was featured in the documentary Crip Camp. She's written a book. There's a brand new book out called Being Human. And I'll let Judy talk about Judy. How about that? It's really lovely to see you. And
nice to be with you. Thank you.
It's just a real honor for me. Seriously, you are somebody I have looked up to for a long time, and you have been on my wish list to talk to on this podcast for a long time. So thank you.
You're welcome.
So 1949, you were born in New York. 47.
I was born in Philadelphia.
There you go.
I only lived there for 3 months. So outside of my passport saying that I was born in Philadelphia, my parents met in Philadelphia. I define myself as someone from Brooklyn because my first 25 years were in Brooklyn.
Mm-hmm. When you talk about your parents, I mean, your parents were different, weren't they, when it came to having a child with a disability? They did something that most parents didn't do at that time. Can you talk a little bit about that?
Sure. My parents, like many other parents, did not expect to have a child that would acquire a disability. Because when I was born, I didn't have a disability. And in 1949, there was a polio epidemic. And so I contracted the virus, kind of similar to what's going on now. Although it didn't happen all year, it seemed to happen more in the summer and the fall, but people didn't know what was causing it. And my mother was also pregnant with my brother. My brother was born in September. I had polio in August. And so there was a lot going on in their life. My parents were Jewish, and my mother and father were each sent out of Germany. Their parents and some grandparents and many other relatives perished in the Holocaust. And so my mother was an only child. And my father came from a family. He had three other brothers. And he came to live in Brooklyn with family. But my mother lived with people that she didn't know. And I think why that's kind of an important dynamic is they were in another country. My father had been in the Marines in the Second World War. They were, you know, tossed out of their countries when they were kids, teenagers. And when they met each other, which is a great story. So in 30 seconds, they met in Philadelphia. And then they did their entire communication via letters. Wow. That my mother and father wrote back and forth, including my father proposing to my mother.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. And so they got married, bought a place in Brooklyn, and there were numbers of other families that were moving in. There was a neighborhood, like a middle class, small homes. And then I had polio, and then my brother came. And so they were kind of making it up as they went along and, you know, made a decision that, you know, I was in the family and they were going to do what they needed to do. And then the first, I think, rude awakening happened when my mom took me to the public school in our neighborhood to enroll me and was told that I couldn't go to the school because I was a fire hazard. Now, this is before... this is the 50s. This is before there were any laws in the U.S. or laws in Canada or laws in other countries that even discussed the issue of discrimination. And discrimination really was not a word that was used at that point, really. And my mom pulled my wheelchair up the steps and then was told, no, I couldn't go to the school because I was a fire hazard.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, they tried to find other places, other schools for me to go to. And I didn't go to school in the first, second, third, or half of the fourth grade. The teacher who was sent by the Board of Education 2.5 hours a week. And so,
well, and you outline this in your book. And if I can just, I just want to read, because I mean, I have my own, you know, I have a child with a disability. I'm his parent, and my experience is as his parent. So when I hear about your mom, I really identify, you know, when I'm reading about her in your book, I identify with where, like how hard she, like she was determined. Yeah. And it's clear in your advocacy and everything that you have done where you got it from. You got it from your parents because they were, well, I can think of them.
Fighters.
Yeah.
You know, they became fighters because, you know, that's not who they were. You know, they really, so I try to paint this picture that they were, you know, immigrants to the United States. My father and his brother set up a butcher store. My mother was raising kids. We were in a neighborhood where people were friendly. Numbers of people had moved in around the same time. So people were helping each other out. But nonetheless, you know, there was nothing in the game plan that said, not only were you going to have a kid with a disability, but, oh, by the way, you are envisioning a life for her like you were envisioning before she acquired her disability. But just a little flag to let you know, you're the only ones that are feeling that way.
Right. Because you write, I mean, it's on the very first page of your book. In many ways, institutionalization was the status quo in 1949. Parents weren't necessarily even encouraged to visit their institutionalized children. Kids with disabilities were considered a hardship. Economically and socially, they brought stigma to the family. People thought that when someone in your family had a disability, it was because you had done something wrong. I think this can still apply to today, Judy.
Yep. Yep. And I don't know that in my family, anybody felt like they had done something wrong. Mm-hmm. But in society overall, you know, some communities believe that it's either a curse from God or a blessing, but not, you know, just a natural thing of life. So they were, I learned many years later that a doctor had in fact suggested that I be institutionalized. They never told me, my parents never told me anything about that. And what they were learning is at that time, if you used a wheelchair when it was time to go to high school, you would go back onto home instruction. So my mother and some other mothers, I don't even know how they found each other, but they definitely did, and began to demand from the Board of Ed that they make high schools accessible. And I was able to see from my parents their vision of what they wanted from me and of me. And I'm sure like you, with your son, do you have any other children?
I do. I have 2 other children, daughters.
So you have 3 kids.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, as a mother, a father, whatever, you know that you're going to have to be an advocate for your child. The question is, how much of an advocate are you going to have to be for your child? And I think, you know, you, I'm sure, like my parents and thousands and millions of other parents around the world, have kids who are either born with a disability or acquire their disability. And if you don't really know much about disability and the way people treat disabled individuals, how discrimination exists, you're learning as you're going. And I think the other issue is that it's frequent that you grow up in a society where people's views towards disabled people are not that we're equals. And so you are a non-disabled person who then acquires a disability. I'm sorry, then as a child, in this case, with a disability, And you're really having to do many things at the same time. You're having to throw away everything that you've seen or not seen. And when I say not seen, it's the lack of appropriate representation of disabled people in media. So there's either no image, or I think maybe now with your 13-year-old son, there may be some more positive images out there, like Peanut Butter Factory and other things where we are seeing people with Down syndrome and other disabilities not always being portrayed in a negative way. But nonetheless, they're few and far between. And so you and your family are having to be making all these changes. Plus, you know, in the case of myself with polio, I was in and out of the hospital for years. And with your son, I'm sure also lots of medical visits dealing with people. You have no idea what they're talking about and having to learn to make decisions and trying to find a network of other people that you can trust and talk to so you can feel informed about decisions that you're making. It's a lot. And I think I'm sure you, like my parents, really, certainly women, are multitaskers. And if we're not multitaskers, God knows what would happen with all these types of things going on.
So when we, you know, this is the 30th anniversary this year of the ADA. And for anyone who doesn't know what that is, in it's the Americans with Disabilities Act. What I found, you know, Crip Camp, if I it should be a mandatory watch, Crip Camp, in every school. I watched it with my 10-year-old. And I watched it for the second time last night with her. And there were a lot of pauses. You know, she would stop it and say, oh, I have a question about this. And yeah, there's a few swear words in there. And there's, you know, whatever. It's real life. I was a little worried when everyone had crabs. And I thought she was going to ask me what that meant. But you know what? It went right over her head, Judy. So I was very happy about that.
But you know, you can get crabs from anything.
Exactly.
It's like getting a tick, right? It's nothing.
So I was really glad when we just kind of went through that. But she had a lot of questions. And, you know, it should be, man, I wish everybody would watch it with their kids, because it shows, gosh, it's such a good documentary. But my point is what I noticed when this group of you were insistent on, like, you were going and you had your sit-in and you were not taking, like, the things that you all went through, like, you can't get up and change yourself. So you're staying night after night after night after night. And I don't think that it's not a matter of, like, me going and sitting down and saying, I'm not going to move until, you know, the secretary comes out and talks to me. It's very different experience for you. And what I noticed was you had a sign language interpreter at every single thing you all did. And we are in a place right now where in the White House, you know, COVID press briefings, there is no sign language interpreter. So for someone like you that has been through decades and decades of fighting for the rights, when, I mean, how does that make you feel when you see this?
So let me just say quickly, you're talking about the demonstrations that happened in San Francisco in 1977. And I think you're right. It's a great thing for people to watch Crip Camp. Whether or not you know anything about disability or not, it's not relevant. It's really as people are meeting each other, coming together, learning that what discrimination individuals have been experiencing is very similar from person to person. And I think we were learning, just like I was observing with my mom, that coming together is very important. So when you look at the film and how it progresses, there are more and more people that are coming together. People with disabilities, family members like yourself and others, who sometimes we call allies. But nonetheless, I think what's very important about what we've seen going on in the US, in Canada, around the world, as a result of the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities and organizations like the International Disability Alliance, people have definitely learned our voices must be more uniform and united. We must be able to support the rights of disabled individuals, regardless of the type of disability that we have. We must be able to say, if you have an intellectual disability, you're blind, you have a learning disability, physical disability, whatever it may be, that discrimination against one adversely impacts our entire community. So I think that's a very important part of both Crip Camp, my book, and other books that are being written. And I think it's one of the critically important parts of the emergence of a disability rights movement. Because really, when you look at the women's movement, other people of color movements, these movements have been evolving for, you know, hundreds of years in many cases. But in the area of disability, it's really been, I think, gradually, like after the First World War, after the Second World War, veterans definitely were playing very prominent roles. Civilians, like your son and myself, the benefits that go to disabled veterans are different than the benefits that civilians get. I want us to be able to get those kinds of supports too. So I think our resilience really continues to grow. Because like when talking about the White House not having sign language interpreters around COVID, so there are a number of very strong deaf organizations in the US and internationally. And a couple of weeks ago, the National Association of the Deaf filed a lawsuit against the White House, against the government, for failing to provide sign language interpreters. Now, would that have happened many years ago? Maybe not. So I think that people are becoming strategic, they're becoming focused, and I think another very important part of what's going on, there are more disabled individuals who, because of changes in laws in our countries, are getting the opportunity to go to school and are getting the opportunity to progress in school, to be going to universities, to be able to get advanced degrees as lawyers, as teachers, as other professional positions, which can then impact the changes that need to go on. I mean, we know that the opportunities still are not anywhere where they need to be. In the US, the unemployment rate for disabled people pre-COVID is astronomical compared to non-disabled people. The impact of COVID in all of our countries around the world for disabled people, I think, is going to be profound and is profound. But one of the hopes that I have is that because we have a movement of disabled people in all countries, various degrees of strength, and because we have international groups also, and the Special Rapporteur on Disability in the UN, that there are more people out there looking earlier and beginning to identify and demand that disabled people not be treated as second-class citizens, and that when those types of things are happening, denial of medical care around COVID because your life is not considered to be as valuable, there are people that are coming in and really trying to address those issues immediately.
Mm-hmm. I think that, you know, COVID has really shown the cracks in how, you know, how disproportionately it affects children and adults with disabilities. And in this country, in Canada, you have the Americans with Disabilities Act. It was only in June of 2019 that here in Canada, we have the Accessible Canada Act, which builds on the Canada Human Rights Act. That's last year. Bill C-81. And I'll tell you, Judy, in this country, and I'm not sure how it is in America when it comes to COVID, but I think I can say pretty honestly that people with disabilities in this country are not treated equally. And I can see that from my son and fighting for his education. And I can see it with people with, you know, disabilities and how they are treated. We can't even say the word disabled in the media, it seems. I worked in television for 22 years. I was a news anchor. And I believe in my 22 years of working in TV, I don't recall seeing anyone with a physical disability on air as a reporter or an anchor or anything like that. And I can't come up with anybody right now off the top of my head in this country doing that. So
I know a woman by the name of Bree Walker many years ago, and she was born with... her fingers aren't typical. And when she started broadcasting, they wanted her to put artificial hands on.
Oh my gosh.
And she refused to do that. She's not, I've lost touch with her, but she's really the only disabled anchor that I've known.
Yeah. So, I mean, I feel like, you know, I'm happy that, you know, in the U.S. Celebrating this 30 years, and in Canada, we seem, okay, well, we've done this, you know, Accessible Canada Act, but here we are in a worldwide pandemic. And in Canada, people with disabilities, we're a country of just under 40 million people. We're, you know, we don't have a huge population. We have 6 million Canadians living with disabilities.
Out of 4 million.
Yes. So people with disabilities were given a one-time $600 payment to get through COVID. In this country, a lot of people with disabilities live in poverty, because it goes back to the employment. It goes back to accessibility. It goes back to everything, right?
Exactly.
So when, what is your advice to somebody like me as a parent, as we are trying to push forward? And Judy, you know this, being a woman, we are accused of being angry. We are accused of, you know, overreacting. We are accused of being emotional. All of these things. How do you pass the torch to our next generation? And how do we take what you and everybody else has built on and take it to the next level?
Yeah. So for me, it's like, when people say passing the torch, it makes me feel like I'm supposed to back up.
No, so, you're not. No.
And I don't mean me personally, but. So I think what I was saying is we really need to continue to grow our movement. We need to have these kinds of discussions. We need to be working more collaboratively together, because as people are entering this world as newbies, they need to be able to get their questions answered. You also need to create your own path. I think new ideas are always important. I think we can learn and listen to other people, but I think it's very important that we work and learn from each other, and to the extent possible, that we try to be working together for the changes that we've all wanted to be making. And I feel very much like you wouldn't be doing this if you were already not a strong advocate,
right?
So you don't need to be, you know, humble. I think, you know, what's the answer? How would you answer the question that you asked me? What needs to be done in order to help address ableism, discrimination, lower expectations? So what's your answer to that?
You're right. I do know the answer to it. I know the answer, and I do it every day. And I use my voice, and I am loud, and I demand things for not only my son, but his friends that also have disabilities.
You work with their parents?
I work with all of their parents. We have a great community. We have, we raise our voices, but I will say, Judy, watching Crip Camp again last night with my 10-year-old, it lit a fire in me again that I needed. I needed that fire again. I needed to see that. I needed to be reminded. And I also think that it's really important to look at a movie like Crip Camp and see what others did and continue. You're right. Continue to do that. We cannot stay complacent, because if we do, we see what happens. We know what happens. And in a lot of ways, I think that people wait for us to be complacent. So you don't need this assistance during COVID, or, you know, yes, it's even a small thing, Judy, like, you know, there's a lot of seniors in long-term care facilities that are dying of COVID. And a lot of those seniors are disabled, but nobody says that.
This is a very important point, because in the U.S., it's the same thing and around the world. So here we have like 50 or 60,000 of the people that have died from COVID who have disabilities. And poverty is a link. And we talk about Black and brown people who are dying at disproportionate rates with underlying conditions, and their underlying conditions are disabilities, exactly as you're saying. So I think it gets back to what you said a few minutes ago. Media is not representing disability appropriately. We don't like to talk about it as a regular part of our work. And so if people really understood disability and what it was, so diabetes is a disability. Hypertension can be a disability. And those are some of the additional disabilities that people may have that's also resulting when they get the virus and they're possibly dying because of the additional issues that they're facing. But it could allow for a broader discussion about underserved populations of people, poor medical care, lack of appropriate training of healthcare providers to understand some of the complexities of medical issues that don't necessarily exist in the white community, but may exist in other communities. So all these things are being exposed. And again, I think we're both hoping that one of the outcomes of COVID is the movement that has been getting stronger, really continuing to be able to move forward and address this issue amongst all the other issues that we're trying to address.
100%. And, you know, to come back to Canada for a second here, and 25 minutes from where I live, Judy, is a place called New Westminster. And there was a school there, it was an institution called Woodlands, and it opened in 1878 and it closed in 1996. And between 1920 and 1959, 3,000 residents were buried on the grounds. And they are all in unmarked markers right now, and unmarked graves. And it is called the Woodlands Memorial Garden. I worry that there are 3,000 people buried in this garden. At one point, the grave markers were used to build the barbecue. That was there for the community. So, I mean, this is a part of our history, 25 minutes from where I live, that I would say if I went out right now and asked 10 people about it, I bet 9.5 of them wouldn't know what I was talking about.
Right.
You know, and so that's what I worry that.
We don't need to worry.
I'm so not going to worry. Wrong word, right?
Exactly. Because the issue is, what do you do? What do you do to ensure that of those 10 people, they are beginning to get some information, and that over the course of the next years, the high school students and elementary school students and the adults are learning about this? In Massachusetts, actually, there is a school where they started doing work around an institution that also had existed. And they also had, I think, 300 grave sites. And the high school students were some of them were beginning to go in and document the history of these people so that they would not, you know, they would have a memory, they would have a name. And so I think there are constructive things that can be done. And exactly as you said, it's the history of why did this happen in the first place? What were people's views towards the people living in the institutions? Why were they taken out of the community? And today, what is different? Because in the States, and I'm sure it's the same in Canada, one of the big issues that we're dealing with is lack of home and community-based services.
Yes.
Lack of community-based services that allow people not to go into these institutions, to be able to live in the community in an accessible place, getting the supports that they need for people, not only to be able to live in their own home, but also to be able to become a part of the community or maintain being a part of the community. So, and I think the value of Crip Camp and my book and others is it's telling people stories. And you are clearly a storyteller. And I think it's very important to get the stories of people in the community, disabled people, and for kids, their parents. So people also learn about not only the struggles and the problems, but how the solutions came about. And in many times, I think it's also valuable to look at the changes that others have made. The principals, the teachers, you know, the religious communities, the neighbor on the street. What did they think before and what do they think now? And why did they think what they thought and how are they changing? It's really, I think, a discussion that is pretty absent because we're not discussing this enough. In the States, I'm working with a group called the Disability Rights Education and Defense Fund. And there's a project called the Disability Media Action Program. And what we're doing is working on identifying the voices of disabled individuals, journalists, filmmakers, people in advertising, to learn about what their experiences have been trying to be professionals in the field, to help create support mechanisms for people in these fields, and to be able to advocate to address the absence, a little bit less absence than 5 years ago, but still a lot of absence and what we need to do and why it's important for it to happen.
Mm-hmm. I know that we have to wrap up soon, but I have a couple more questions. Ableism. What does ableism mean? What does it mean to be an ableist?
Ableism to me is ridiculing someone who's a little person, going up to a disabled person and asking what's wrong with you. Doing things that you wouldn't do for anyone else, using pejorative terms, bullying people because of their disabilities in school or as adults. And then the double, triple discrimination that disabled people of color, of different religious backgrounds, different sexual orientations. I think that's an important part of what's been going on also in our society in general, is recognizing that people are usually multiple things and people are wanting to be able to bring the totality of who they are to the forefront because that's who you are, right? So I'm Judy Heumann. I'm a disabled Jewish woman who's white. And I want to be able to feel comfortable in the disability community, in the Jewish community, in the women's community, and in society in general. And if I can't bring all of that together, then it's difficult for me to even know who I really am and difficult for other people to know who I am. My disability is a visible disability, but it doesn't mean that you necessarily speak about who you are because you, in many cases, people are always trying to hide who we are and what we need, as opposed to, you know, really being able to talk about who we are and what we need in order to be able to function within our communities, on the job, in society overall. I mean, as someone who needs personal assistance, I need help going to the bathroom. And in the film, you know, you see this scene where I get emotional about when am I going to be able to see myself equal if I can't use the bathroom? I talk about bathrooms a lot because people don't want to talk about bathrooms. People don't want to hear about any of the personal things that one needs. I think it's another issue around nursing homes and around people who work as personal assistants. Those people are not regarded as valuable in many cases. They're not paid appropriately in many cases. But it also is, you know, that they're considered like saints for doing work with these kinds of people, as opposed to, you know, someone working with your son in school to help him learn to do whatever he is able to do and making sure he's got the right supports and professional supports.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I get emotional when you were talking about that because you're right. You know, I went to my son's high school. He's going into high school in September, starting in grade 8. And when we went for our meeting, you know, and we went to the room, and the room he's in is in the basement. So of course that immediately
for me. Classes.
Yeah. So in high school, you know, we love to pride ourselves on inclusion, and his elementary school was a wonderful experience for him. But I don't think I didn't have to fight tooth and nail for every single thing he got for the last 8 years. And it was a wonderful experience. Now we're heading into this new world. When we were there, and there were some other parents there and my husband, and I was the only one that asked questions. And I asked a lot. It was one question after another. And I said, well, what will he do? Because I'm looking, oh, they go swimming every day. Oh, my son knows how to swim. Oh, well, and then they'll go to the store and learn how to buy something, and they'll fold the laundry. And I said, oh, yeah, he knows how to fold laundry. And, oh, well, a lot of the kids do recycling. And I said, oh, okay. And, you know, and when
learning.
That's what I said. And, you know, so when I did say something on, you know, I use my social media to sort of use my voice, because I have a little bit of a voice on social media, not much, but a little one. And I did talk about recycling. And it's funny when people push back on that, they're like, oh, well, you know, it's, you know, it's fun and it's this and it's that. And it's like, no. Are all the kids doing recycling? Are the A+ students in, you know, are they out doing the recycling? So when you were just talking about that small bit, boy, that hit me. That really hit me because, you know, when you're
not going to be going to any of the other classes.
No, maybe PE. So yeah, Judy.
I don't know your son, but that's definitely the wrong answer.
Yeah. I know. And I know that. And so, you know, this conversation has really, you know, like I said, reignited what was already ignited. So my last question, I think, because every time you speak, I have 10 more questions. Inspiration porn.
So when a disabled person does something that a non-disabled person does, and people get all excited about something a disabled person did that's really not exceptional, getting up in the morning, eating your breakfast, doing this or that, which is typical for other people to do, talking about how brave and wonderful, you know, the person is for doing this, is really insulting. And I think it's infantilizing. You know, it's not looking at where that person is in life and where they need to be going and what we need to be doing to help support that person moving forward. And so I think the word inspiration is one that in general we need to use selectively. I mean, there are things that inspire you, right? Great painters inspire you. So if you're a disabled person and you're a great painter, that's cool. You're inspirational because you're doing something which is not typical, right? It's above. And I think people are feeling like when words like inspirational and brave and all these words are being used, it is ableism. And, you know, like racism and sexism, ableism is not necessarily intentional, right? You don't know that it is ableist. So you need to learn that it is ableist. So people do need to learn that when you're saying that somebody who does something which is typical, they're not inspirational. You know, maybe it took a village to help that person get to where they are. And that's really what needs to be analyzed is why was that true? That it wasn't something that just was able to happen. But we need to not be treating disabled people differently as children, when they're adults, and on and on. So,
yeah. And I think that this is, I mean, I didn't know about inspiration porn until just a few weeks ago. I really didn't. And now that I know about it, I can't not know about it.
So what is inspiration porn to you?
Well, I'll tell you what it is. And it's really made me reflect at being in television for, you know, 22 years. How many times did we tell a story of, you know, the football star that asked the girl with Down syndrome to prom?
Exactly.
How many times did we do a story on the boy with cerebral palsy that bowled? He went bowling. How many times did we, and now with social media, it is everywhere. We are bombarded with it. And now that I know it, I want everybody to know what inspiration porn is, because it doesn't serve anyone.
And it's the question also of, you know, why is this kid not able to be involved in some sports activity? Why is it such a big deal? You know, because we've had all those things here too, right? The disabled kid that was allowed to do whatever. I'm like, what do you mean allowed to, right? This kid has a right to be able to not necessarily be on the varsity team because they're not good enough, but what are the other activities that are going on that they're being excluded from just because they want to be involved in sports?
Yeah. Yeah. I'm glad that I got that one in, because I think that's important for people to know. Judy, you are, I could talk to you obviously for probably months and years.
Another discussion, but yeah. I really just want to say that, you know, I'm older, I've done more things. I've been very fortunate to be able to work with tremendous people in the United States and Canada, around the world, as we, you know, together are fighting and moving forward. And I think it's very important that we learn about the stories of people in our communities with visible and invisible disabilities, because the majority of people have invisible disabilities, you know, like diabetes and depression and anxiety and bipolar. And now with COVID and things that mental health issues that are going on, I think we need to be able to understand the breadth of what disability is. We need to really be reaching out to people who feel ashamed and embarrassed, because whatever, to really allow people to see that they are part of our community, and that together we really can become a stronger force to contend with. Mm-hmm. And probably strengthen some of the laws in Canada.
Exactly.
And here also.
Yes.
Enforcement.
So I just want to remind Judy, I want to remind everybody that you can find Judy's book. It looks like this. It's called Being Human. Look at all my little markers. I had so many things to ask you about. That is wherever you buy books. You can also follow her and find more about the human perspective on Instagram at the human perspective. And so that's HEUMANN. She's on Twitter at Judith Heumann, or on Facebook at thehumanperspective.com.
Have a YouTube channel.
Oh, geez. You're busy.
And the book is written by me and a woman named Kristen Joyner.
That's right.
And I really want to give her credit.
Yes.
We'll have a whole other discussion about that.
Oh, yes.
And, I also want to say that the book is also on audio, and the audio was read by a woman named Ali Stroker, who actually is in Canada right now doing a film. She is the first wheelchair user to perform on Broadway in the United States, and in 2018 won the Tony Award for a female singer in a revival, and the revival was Oklahoma.
And so she did your book for the audio version.
She read the book. She's,
wow.
And also, if any of you watch a program called Drunk History, she played me in Drunk History a couple of years ago. And that's when we became friends, and she's great.
Amazing. So, well, thank you. No, thank you so much, Judy. I really appreciate your time. You're a gem. And thank you for reigniting everything I needed. So thank
and
you.
Maybe we'll talk again.
Yes, you bet.
Thank you.
Thanks for listening to another episode of TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Be sure to subscribe so you can join us every Tuesday for another conversation. You can also check out our website, telus.com/podcast, and subscribe to our YouTube channel at TELUS Talks.